Sometimes I think we have to de-horror our lives from what we've experienced in that stinking, filthy mess called church. And here's another one of those things about prayer. Now, to pray just means to ask. Okay. In the old days, in ancient English, they would have said, when they say, I prithee, means I pray thee, it's a truncated form, and it means I ask you. Okay. To pray just means to ask. Now, how would you respond to your father, your natural father, assuming you've got one and he's approachable, and God knows there's a fair old mixture on that front, but nevertheless, how would you approach your father? You just go in and speak to him, say, I need so and so and so and so. Can I have this and that and the other? And your father will say, well, yeah, okay, fine, no problem, or not this week, next week, or something like that. Now, you know, you and I may not have had a good father, but you know that there's examples in Scripture, you know, if his son asks him bread, will he give him a stone? And those things Jesus said, didn't he? Our Father will give us all things richly to enjoy, which is good for us. He's not going to give you a hand grenade with a pin taken out, is he? Or anything like that. You know, he's good. He's a good father. He's not like earthly fathers who can be pretty bad. Excuse me. Is that right? But I can remember being infected by a number of people, because when you're first saved, you'll notice that church people are desperate for you to be churchified. And here we're going to be de-churchifying people as part of what I do, of course. And they give you loads of books written by this person. Oh, this is a great man of God of the past. He's C.T. Studd, or he's, you know, anyone else. You know, there's books by this one and that one. Oh, you should listen to this and read that and all the rest of it. Book by, trying to think of his name now. You know, there's a couple of Chinese men that were written about, and Wang Ming Dao was one of them, and all these kinds of things. You've got to read this, you've got to read that, and all this kind of stuff. And one man that was spoken of, I heard spoken of many years ago, and I've not heard his name mentioned recently, was a man called Hyde, as in Mr. Hyde. I can't remember his first name. I don't know if he even knew it, but because he was always known as Praying Hyde, because he used to spend a lot of time in prayer, apparently. And apparently where he knelt by his bed to pray, would you like to show me kneeling to pray in Scripture? It just doesn't happen, does it? This is a Catholic pagan kind of thing, isn't it? But he used to kneel by his bed in prayer, and apparently where he knelt, he'd worn dips in the wooden floorboards where he'd kneel to pray. And you think, my goodness, you must have spent quite a long time doing that if you've actually done that. But nevertheless, Praying Hyde. But hang on a minute. The Scripture says that the Lord doesn't hear us for our much speaking. Is that right? And, you know, he doesn't hear us because of the volume of our words. We don't pray to God in wrath and doubting. The Scriptures abundantly, he doesn't hear us for our much speaking, as the King James Bible puts it. And in fact, Scripture says quite plainly, he's in heaven, you're on earth, let your words be few. The simple, straightforward model for prayer Jesus gave, I mean, is pretty brief, isn't it? So this man Praying Hyde, I have to say, I've come to come suspicious position of this, that he just didn't understand. Well, okay, we'll allow the man made gross errors and mistakes and didn't know the Scriptures on that particular subject or whatever, and had this pagan idea, like a bunch of Catholics, thinking that you're going to batter your doors of heaven down by spending hours and hours in prayer. A bit like the likes of Hillsong from Australia, who think that by three-hour praise and worship sessions is going to move God, like a bunch of drongos. Honestly, this Scripture is abundantly clear The Lord God of Israel, our Father, sees and hears all things at all times and knows everything anyway. What are you going to tell him he doesn't know? You only have to point out something to him and, you know, of course he's seen it anyway. Ask, Lord, I need resolution in this area, or this particular issue and that issue. Lord, I can't fix this. And we leave it with him, don't we? So when you start to hear things like praying hide and all this kind of stuff, remember what the Lord said in the scriptures. He doesn't hear for our much speaking. Regardless of how much you shout and talk at him, nothing will be changed. Nothing will be availed. So we just tell our Lord, that's it, and we leave it there. Most of the time, if I'm sitting speaking to the Lord, I'm just communing with him. I'm just in spiritual contact, and he may show me something. And I say, well, yes, Lord, and what about this, that? And he'll show me the next thing. Ah, okay, Lord, thank you. And then he'll show me this, and he'll show me that. Okay, but he shows me by revelation. And this is why church people never see anything. All these people who are intellectual and clever need to know what the scripture says. God said, as Jesus himself uttered, thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent and revealed them unto babes. If he wants you and I to know something, he just shows you. He doesn't need to speak as such. He shows you in your inner being and you see it, don't you? And you understand spiritual and things of God far better than any of these twerps from Bible colleges and all the rest of it. Don't you? Because you've seen it for yourself. He showed you. They've read about it in a book. Which is why all these book-loaned people in church are so utterly lifeless, godless, dead and hopeless. They haven't got anything. They've only got intellect between the ears and learning between the ears, which is hopeless. Our Father speaks to his people. He doesn't sit there passively waiting for you to get on your knees for 2 or 3 hours and pray. Goodness sake. He just wants communion with us. That praying hide character, he must have had a really kind of pagan view of who God was and what he was about. Like a bunch of pathetic Catholics. I can remember seeing a photo of some Catholic church somewhere with a flight of stone steps up to a church up the top. And these crows of Catholicism, magpies of Catholicism in black and white, the nuns going up these stairs on their knees until their knees bled to get to the top to go and pray, to hope God would hear them and pray to the goddess Mary, of course, in the hope that Mary would batter this stubborn, difficult and wrathful Jesus into submission and they would get what they wanted. Where'd you get that idea from? You didn't get it from anyone of God. The early Christians didn't believe such garbage. What the hell are you doing believing it? So please, let's de-churchify our thinking. Please. We don't need to assail heaven with prayers the whole time. If you believe like that, you're in the old covenant. In the new covenant, we have Christ in us, the hope of heaven. In the old covenant, heaven was up there, we're down here, and we have to do things to get God's attention. We don't do that in the New Testament, in the new covenant. Church people have no idea there's been any covenant change at all. They just do a old covenant style religion painted with New Testament words. They just don't idea, no idea what the truth actually is, none whatsoever. And even if you could batter them to the correct doctrine, all they do is, you know, give their whole religion a fresh lick of paint, of camouflage paint, using the new words and names, but they haven't been changed in their hearts on the inside. And we've wasted our time completely. Let's de-churchify ourselves. It is unworthy of a disciple to be doing this kind of thing. We were in that stinking filth called church, the grey monster, where they borrow bits from the light and bits from the sewage and darkness and produce this grey religion where nobody knows God and everything's in a fog. No one's got any revelation or any light, and they're all full of nonsense. Curiously, as an aside, I heard Benny Hinn, who I happened to catch a couple of phrases from whilst clicking through the horrors thing on my computer in my favourite section, my browser. I have a Daily Horrors browser folder, and in there is the links to all the, you know, the horrors like God TV, Revelation TV, Love World USA, and I might just quickly nip through in a moment, idle moment, you know. And I caught Benny Hinn saying, all these young people, what they want today is that the people want to go back to what they used to be. They want what their grandparents used to say to them. They want the things, the old solid spiritual Christian stuff, not the modern upbeat thrashing, bashing and crashing stuff. They want to get back to something real and something solid. And I thought, well, that's an interesting observation coming from Benny Hinn. And I don't doubt for a moment that this is going round at the moment, but it's too late now. You know, Satan's people like Copeland, Hagen, Hinn, Sorello, and umpteen others, Rick Warren, Rick Joyner, and all the other children of the devil playing Christian, have led millions off into the grey monster and destroyed them. And there's no way back for those who tasted of God, of course, and have gone away. And that's very interesting, isn't it? So let's de-churchify, please. Let's test everything carefully. Check it. Did the Lord say that? Or is this just a bunch of church people spouting stuff that people have done before? They like to try and legitimize their religion by using the names of people went before. I caught a website earlier on of the Bible College of Wales, started by Rhys Howells. There's a book going around called Rhys Howells called Intercessor. I can't remember if it's about him or written by him now, but whatever. It's called Intercessor anyway. And Rhys Howells, some sort of preacher, minister, character, a Welshman, started this Bible college. And I had a quick look at this Bible college thing now. And I can tell you, the pastor and his missus are foreigners. The graduation picture I saw, one graduation picture, most of them were women. Rhys Howells wouldn't have tolerated that. In a million years, he knew darn well God doesn't put women in authority. What on earth are you doing at Bible college on your way? And Revelation TV was running an interview with a woman who'd been to this college, the Bible College of Wales. And, you know, they were talking to this woman as though she was legitimate. So let's de-churchify our thinking, please. God's ordinance is very, very clear. And it's not there to be circumvented and ignored. All right? So let's not just take on board what's happened before because somebody who's well known of the past used to do something, or this person over there used to be a great name they've got. As soon as they start exalting people, mere human beings who happen to be God's people, or indeed were just church people, watch it. Because a true disciple only exalts the Lord Jesus himself, and is listening for Jesus to speak. You don't be afraid to heave overboard everything and everyone that's wrong, erroneous in any way whatsoever. You will never come in to the pure truth if you start feeding on ridiculous corruption.